الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين وبعد فقد قال جل وعلا في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل لن يصيبنا إلا ما كتب الله لنا هو مولانا وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم الصبر عند صدمة الأولى أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله المولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders and friends, it has become a very common practice today that due to the weakness of our health, due to the deteriorating condition of our health, often a person will present in a drug store, in a pharmacy, in a local chemist, and he will ask for some tonic, he will ask for some vitamin, he will ask for some immune booster. I'm feeling lame, I'm feeling lethargic, I'm feeling weak, I'm feeling feeble. Can you give me something just to boost my immune system? Just to give me some strength and some power and vigor. Sometimes you get it in an oral form, sometimes you get it in a tablet form. There are different things that are available across the counter. Today I thought, in my first address on this particular trip, I present before you a spiritual immune booster. Something that will give you that energy, that strength and that vigor to receive and embrace the blessed month of Ramadan. And what am I referring to here? I'm referring to some of the profound couplets of the great giant Muhammad bin Idris al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, where he makes a synopsis, he makes an estimation of the global picture of the world. And often I say, and I would repeat, that many of the utterances of our pious predecessors have more meaning today than it had at the time they uttered it. So it is as if they uttered it and said it for us. It is as if they said it for us. At that time it was not so apt and so meaning and so direct as it is today. So briefly, time is short. The couplets of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he says, addressing us and the general condition of this world, دَعِ الْأَيَّامَ دَعِ الْأَيَّامَ تَغْدِرُ كُلَّ حِينٍ وَلَا تَجْزَعْ لِحَادِثَةِ اللَّيَالِ فَمَا لِحَوَادِثِ الدُّنْيَا بَقَاءُ. He says, leave the world alone. It will rotate on its axis and it will do as it has been instructed by Allah to do. Sometimes it will flavor you with beautiful rain. At times it will subject you to catastrophes and tsunamis. It is under the divine command of Allah. But rather, O man, O the son of Adam, you do what you have to do. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu used to say, it is better for you to bite onto live coal, hatta tutfa, until it is extinguished, than for you to desire that the decree of Allah was different in your favor. It is better for you to bite onto live coal till it's extinguished, than to aspire and desire that had Allah changed His decree, it would have been better. No. دَعِي الْأَيَّامِ, leave the world to do what it has to do. And what must you do? وَلَا تَجْزَعْ لِحَادِثَةِ اللَّيَالِ فَمَا لِحَوَادِثِ الدُّنْيَا بَقَاءُ. Do not moan or groan or lose your focus when occasionally the waters around you are stormy. The winds are aggressive. The tides are high. It's stormy around you. You're in the dead ocean. Do not despair and do not lose hope on your Creator. ولا تجزع لحادثة الليالي فما لحوادث الدنيا بقاء وكن رجلا على الأهوال جلدا وشيمتك السماحة والوفاء. And in all matters hold on to strength and perseverance and display the character of tolerance and perseverance even in the face of hostility. It is very easy to be kind to someone when he is kind. That is reciprocating nobility with virtue. But how about someone who is aggressive to you? So some people came and they greeted our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a very abrupt way. They were very harsh to him. وَإِذَا جَاءُوكَ حَيَّوكَ بِمَا لَمْ يُحَيِّكَ بِهِ اللَّهِ وَيَقُولُونَ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ لَوْلَا يُعَذِّبُنَا اللَّهُ بِمَا نَقُولُ. They did not say assalamu alaik, which means may the peace of Allah be upon you. They twisted their tongue and they said assalamu alaik, which means may death come upon you, may ruination come upon you, may destruction come upon you. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was the most articulate of every Arab, who was the most profound, who was a linguistic, who understood the evil nature of the slant in their tongue, he didn't reply and retort with aggression. He said wa alaik, wa alaik, and the same to you. Our mother Aisha radiallahu anha was in rage and anger, and she said, oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did you not see what they said? Why don't you reply? He said, I have replied and I have said without compromising the borders of respect, without compromising the garb of dignity, without trespassing the parameters of virtue, without losing himself. He said, wa alayk, the same to you. O Aisha, if they have brought goodness to me, then may goodness come upon them. And if they have invoked evil to me, in a very dignified, measured and calculated way, I said the same to you. So وَكُنْ رَجُلًا عَلَى الْأَهْوَالِ جَلْدًا. He says, be strong and perseverant. You know, I am reminded of five advisors of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and I will run to it very quickly. He said, take five things from me and you have achieved everything of life. Now, I'm not saying it. The man whose name is synonymous to knowledge. Speak of knowledge and you think of Ali radiallahu anhu. Speak of Ali radiallahu anhu and you think of knowledge. He said, لا يخافن أحد إلا ذنبه. In life, you must take consideration of a lot of things. You've got to be careful of traffic. You've got to be conscious of time. You've got to be aware of the fluctuation of the currency. You've got to see the volatility of the markets. You've got to see a lot of things in life. But there's only one thing you must fear. You mustn't fear nothing. Don't fear the condition of the world. Don't fear the economic condition. Don't fear anything. You must only fear one thing. لا يخافن أحد إلا ذنبه. And that is the consequences of your sins and your wrong and your vice. So the other things in life you must worry about, you must be concerned about. We're not saying become negligent and careless and heedless and unmindful and you know what, just ignore things. No, no. Understand it objectively. You must take care of it. But it doesn't allow you to lose your sleep because of the currency. It mustn't allow you to lose your comfort and your ease because of fear of the markets, because of job, because of politics, because of sports, because of games, winning, lose. No, 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 no. لا يخافن أحد إلا ذنبه. If there's only thing that justifies you losing your sleep, it's your sins. Number two, ولا يرجو إلا ربه. And don't invest your hopes in anyone but your Lord. Don't invest your hopes. In fact, we are going through such a crisis that I don't think it would be wrong for me to say, don't even invest your hopes in your children. Don't even invest your hopes. That is a castle of hopes that I'm shaping as this boy matures, as he reaches his teens, as he reaches this age, he will do this for me, and he will really... No, no, no. وَلَا يَرْجُوا إِلَّا رَبَّهُ. You only put your hopes on your Lord. That's it. Number three, وَلَا يَسْتَحْيِي مَنْ لَا يَعْلَمْ أَنْ يَتَعَلَّمْ. The one who doesn't know must not feel shy. He must approach the learned and he must start learning immediately. It's not below your dignity and you haven't compromised your name if you go to someone and learn. Number four, I'm just going through it quickly. Number four, وَلَا يَسْتَحْيِي مَنْ لَا يَعْلَمْ إِذَا سُئِلَ عَمَّا لَا يَعْلَمْ أَنْ يَقُولَ لَا أَعْلَمْ. And the one who doesn't know, if somebody asks him something he doesn't know, he mustn't feel shy, he must be honest, he must be candid, he must be accurate. My brother, I don't know. If I'm going to give you a verdict on this, that is a shot in the dark and it's a thumb suck, I cannot support this here. So those who don't know mustn't feel shy to learn. Those who don't know, when they are asked, they must be honest and accurate that we don't know. And then he says, and I tie it up with the couplet of Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayh, وَإِنَّ الصَّبْرَ مِنَ الْجَسَدِ كَمَنْزِلَةِ الرَّأْسِ وَإِنَّ الصَّبْرَ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ كَمَنْزِلَةِ الرَّأْسِ مِنَ الْجَسَدِ. The position of patience in Islam is like the head in the body. Just as there is no human without a head, there is no iman without sabr. There is no iman without sabr. This is very, very important, we need to realize. So what does Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi say? وَكُنْ رَجُلًا عَلَى الْأَهْوَالِ جَلْدًا وَشِيمَتُكَ السَّمَاحَةُ وَالْوَفَاءُ وَإِنْ كَثُرَتْ عُيُوبُكَ فِي الْبَرَايَا وَصَرَّكَ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهَا غِطَاءُ تَسَتَّرْ بِالسَّخَاءِ فَكُلُّ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِّيهِ كَمَا قِيلَ السَّخَاءُ. If perchance you have sinned excessively, and rest assured every one of us have sinned excessively, none of us are there that can claim otherwise. He gives you a formula, a recipe, an example how you can conceal your wrong. تَسَتَّرْ بِالسَّخَاءِ فَكُلُّ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِّيهِ. Develop a generous hand, a giving hand, a gracious hand, a favoring hand. And the more you spend, the more it will camouflage, the more it would conceal, the more it would cover your sins and your vice. In fact, in one narration I read, that if there's any person on the day of Qiyamah, whose generosity will assist him even in hell, will be a person who used to spend in this world, despite his disbelief, some form of drop in his torment will take place in hell due to his generosity. So obviously we're not saying that he would be granted deliverance from hell, but as a result of his generosity, يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُ, his torment will be reduced somewhat. So he goes on to say, تَسَتَّرْ بِالسَّخَاءِ فَكُلُّ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِّيهِ. One person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he asked for something. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him. Then another person came and he asked for something, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him. And a third person came and he said, I don't have, but you can go and buy on my name. So someone stood up from the audience and he said, سُئِلْتَ فَأَعْطَيْتَ سُئِلْتَ فَأَعْطَيْتَ. You were asked once, you gave. You were asked the second time, you gave. Oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why do you burden yourself when you don't have? Now Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a very modest and a very bashful person. He wouldn't say anything, but his blessed face gave off rage and anger. And they realized that we have offended him. And then another person stood up and he said, oh Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, give. And don't fear poverty, Allah will give you even more. And suddenly his face was radiating and it was beaming. And he said, بِهَذَا أُمِرْتُ. The gentleman who has made this slogan has in essence understood the essence of my mission. He has understood the essence of my mission. فَكُلُّ عَيْبٍ يُغَطِّيهِ كَمَا قِيلَ الصَّفَاءُ. Then he goes on to say, وَلَا تُرِ لِلْأَعَادِي ذُلًّا قَتُّ فَإِنَّ شَمَاتَةَ الْأَعْدَاءِ بَلَاءُ. Whatever happens, don't display your weakness before your foe and your enemy, because you are giving them reason to clap hands and to rejoice over your pain, which will only compound and exacerbate your crisis. This is something that is so pertinent and so pivotal and so important today, that at least as Muslims we can show a united front. وَلَا تُرِ لِلْأَعَادِ ذُلًّا قَتُّ. Do not show your weakness, do not show your feebleness, do not show your inability to fellow to your foe, to your enemy. فَإِنَّ شَمَاتَةَ الْأَعْدَاءِ بَلَاءُ. Otherwise you are equipping them with your weakness,
and you're giving them grounds to laugh and to scoff and to mock at you.
وَلَا تَرْجُ السَّمَاحَةَ مِنْ بَخِيلٍ فَمَا فِي النَّارِ لِلضَّمْآنِ مَاءُ
وَلَا تَرْجُ السَّمَاحَةَ مِنْ بَخِيلٍ And do not hope for kindness from a person who by his very nature is a miser. You're not going to get good out of him. To ask or to expect good from him is like expecting the fire to quench your thirst.
فَمَا فِي النَّارِ لِلضَّمْآنِ مَاءُ فَمَا فِي النَّارِ لِلضَّمْآنِ مَاءُ وَلَا تَرْجُ السَّمَاحَةَ مِنْ بَخِيلٍ فَمَا فِي النَّارِ لِلضَّمْآنِ مَاءُ
وَرِزْقُكَ لَيْسَ يَنْقُسُهُ التَّأَنِّي وَلَيْسَ يَزِيدُ فِي الرِّزْقِ الْعَنَاءُ And remember, your sustenance, your wealth, your income, whether you exert yourself, you assert yourself, or occasionally you might not be so active, you will not up or increase that which Allah has determined and decreed for you. The other Arabic poet said it very beautifully.
وَمِنَ الدَّلِيلِ وَمِنَ الدَّلِيلِ عَلَى الْقَضَاءِ وَحُكْمِهِ بُؤْسُ اللَّبِيبِ وَطِيبُ عِيشِ الْأَحْمَقِ
The proof that sustenance has been decreed by Allah. Sometimes you find a person who is old, who is weak, who's not mentally so strong, who might be senile, who might be have many other conditions, but subhanallah, he has an empire, he has a kingdom. And on the reverse, a man would have multiple diplomas and he might be looking for a job. So what is Imam Shafi exhorting? Don't over-assert yourself. What has been ordained for you will come your way.
وَرِزْقُكَ لَيْسَ يَنْقُسُهُ التَّأَنِّي وَلَيْسَ يَزِيدُ فِي الرِّزْقِ الْعَنَاءُ وَلَا حُزْنٌ يَدُومُ وَلَا سُرُورٌ وَلَا بُؤْسٌ عَلَيْكَ وَلَا رَخَاءُ
The greatest consolation of the tragedies of this world is that it is not here permanently. Embrace it. In English they say there are two words. I hope I'm being understood. They say there is expecting and accepting. There are two words in the English language. One is you expecting. I'm expecting wealth. I'm expecting respect. I'm expecting dignity. Expecting will end up in tears. And the other word is accepting. Embracing. And accepting will end up in tears. Tears is laughter, happiness. Today what happens? Many marriages break up. Why? Because the levels of expectation are too high. She has to do this for me and he has to do that for me. And the child is expecting too much and the demands are too much.
وَلَا حُزْنٌ يَدُومُ وَلَا سُرُورٌ وَلَا بُؤْسٌ عَلَيْكَ وَلَا رَخَاءُ إِذَا مَا كُنْتَ ذَا قَلْبٍ قَنُوعٍ فَأَنْتَ وَمَالِكُ الدُّنْيَا سَوَاءُ
If you can develop contentment, then you and the man who owns the whole world are equal. Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi said in another poem of his,
سَهِرَتْ عُيُونٌ وَنَامَتْ أَعْيُنُ فِي أُمُورٍ تَكُونُ أَوْ لَا تَكُونُ
He said that depression has become the order of the day. Some people are so depressed that they cannot sleep. Others fell off to sleep, but in their sleep they dreaming about their worries.
سَهِرَتْ عُيُونٌ
Some eyes are awake. Some eyes have been gripped by insomnia. If you study in the medical world today, one of the biggest problems is insomnia. He cannot fall off to sleep. There's a certain pattern, there's a certain rhythm, there's certain tablets, there's an orthopedic pillow, there's an orthopedic bed. You have to dim the lights, you have to complement the MB. Oh my word! Oh my word! What a world are we living in?
سَهِرَتْ عُيُونٌ وَنَامَتْ أَعْيُنُ
Some eyes are awake, others are sleeping. Those that are awake, what's going to happen tomorrow? Why?
فِي أُمُورٍ تَكُونُ أَوْ لَا تَكُونُ
Why are they all restless? Because something might happen or it might not happen. I hope the results are negative. I hope the cancer cells are not spreading in the body. I hope it's benign as the medical term and it's not malignant and it's spreading. I hope the job is secured. I hope the proposal is yes. I hope the visa has been approved.
فِي أُمُورٍ تَكُونُ أَوْ لَا تَكُونُ فَادْرَئِ الْهَمَّ عَنِ النَّفْسِ
فَحِمْلَانُكَ الْهُمُومَ جُنُونُ. Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi said, the average human has become a vessel and a vehicle of anxiety, which is tantamount to insanity. He's nothing more than a vehicle moving with just worry and depression, worry and depression. إِنَّ رَبَّا كَفَاكَ بِالْأَمْسِ مَا كَانَ سَيَكْفِيكَ فِي غَدٍ مَا يَكُونُ. That Allah that nurtured you hasn't become inactive, that you have to make alternate arrangements for tomorrow. The Allah that has raised you hasn't handed over His powers that you have to take over. وَلَا حُزْنٌ يَدُومُ وَلَا سُرُورٌ وَلَا بُؤْسٌ عَلَيْكَ وَلَا رَخَاءُ إِذَا مَا كُنْتَ ذَا قَلْبٍ قَنُوعٍ فَأَنْتَ وَمَالِكُ الدُّنْيَا سَوَاءُ وَمَنْ نَزَلَتْ بِسَاحَتِهِ الْمَنَايَا فَلَا أَرْضٌ تَقِيهِ وَلَا سَمَاءُ. And remember, the land of Allah and the earth of Allah is broad, it's vast. You can travel and traverse the earth, but the very broad land will become extremely narrow when the angel of death knocks your door. This land is very broad. You can fly from one end to the other. And some countries will boast that domestic flights, you can fly for 6 hours. You remain within our empire, within our boundaries, within our airspace, and you fly in 6 hours, and there's different time zones within a common country. And Imam Shafi says, yes indeed, the world of Allah is very broad and very vast. But when the angel of death knocks your door, that very vast land becomes narrow. وَأَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةٌ لَكِنْ إِذَا نَزَلَ الْقَبَى ضَاقَ الْفِضَاءِ. And what did he say? وَضَمَّةُ الْقَبْرِ تُنْسِي لَيْلَةَ الْعُرْسِ. He said the pleasure or the difficulty and the agony of the squeeze of the grave will surely make you forget the pleasure of your first nights. When you got married and you had the most exotic place, at the most breathtaking view, the first squeeze of the grave will make you forget that. Now we are at the beginning of the month of Ramadan, and I want to share with you one incident, and I hope that can stimulate us to embrace Ramadan with the correct spirit. You know, somebody said it very beautifully, what is 15 Sha'ban? 15 Sha'ban is like a pre-wash. You know, sometimes you have your clothing, you're going to give it a thorough wash, but you have these stubborn stains, they call them. These marks that wouldn't come out. So you apply some detergent on it, and you give it a bit of a rub, and you reduce the color, you lessen the scar, you lessen the mark on the clothing, and you give it a pre-wash, and then in Ramadan you give it a thorough wash. We are on the verge of going into a thorough wash. Have we prepared ourselves? Have we spinned ourselves? Have we drenched ourselves? Here is an incident that Ibn Qudama rahmatullah alayhi makes mention of it in his famous kitab, Kitab al-Tawwabin. It is on page 82 and 83. So he says, in the time of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, كان شاب مسرف في بني إسرائيل. There was one person in the time of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. He was a young boy, but he was a sinner, he was a transgressor. He had committed every vice you can think of. فأخرجوه من بينهم لسوء فعله. The nature of his crime was such that it was contagious. So the people complained to Musa alayhi salam, can you please expel this man, because he is corrupting our youth in the community. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam told him, brother, can you please go out and live somewhere in the jungle, in some foreign place, but not here, because really people cannot live with you. They cannot coexist with you. Anyway, he went there and he lived there. At the time that it was ordained for him to die, he passed away at the location, like the Arabic poet said, وَمَنْ كُتِبَتْ مَنِيَّتُهُ بِأَرْضٍ فَلَيْسَ يَمُوتُ فِي أَرْضٍ سِوَاهَا. وَمَنْ كُتِبَتْ مَنِيَّتُهُ بِأَرْضٍ, whoever's death has been decreed at a particular location, surely he will not die an inch ahead or an inch behind. Spot on at that time, he will pass away. إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُ اللَّهِ. When the decree of Allah comes, when the time of Allah comes, it will not be delayed. When this man passed away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent wahi to Musa alayhi salam, إِنَّ وَلِيًّا مِّنْ أَوْلِيَائِي قَدْ حَضَرَهُ الْمَوْتُ فَأَحْضِرْهُ وَغَسِّلْهُ وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِ.
وكل من كثر عصيانه يحضر جنازته لأغفر لهم.
O Musa, one of my beloved friends have passed away, and I instruct you that you attend his funeral, and you with your blessed hands wash him, give him ghusl, wrap him in his kafan and lower him in the grave. And furthermore, I am going to be giving out blanket forgiveness. Anybody who attends my friend's funeral, by sheer attendance, he will be privileged with forgiveness.
So Musa alayhi salam announced, listen people, one man has passed away, he is the friend of Allah. And Allah has said, whoever attends his funeral will be forgiven. When this announcement was made, did the people come in their multitudes, in their scores, in their droves, in their numbers? And when finally they come, people will speak, you're not going to hold their tongues back. When they looked at him, the narration Ibn Qudama, they said, هذا هو الفاسق الذي أخرجناه.
Oh Musa, what are you talking? He's a wicked, he's a delinquent, he's a sinner. He's committed every crime, he's guilty of infidelity, he's guilty of disloyalty, he's guilty of this vice, he's consumed alcohol, he's done the wrong you can think of.
فَتَعَجَّبَ مُوسَى مِنْ ذَلِكَ
Musa alayhi salam was astonished, and he said, Oh Allah, this is what you told me, but this is what your creation are saying, that they identified him as the same. And reflect over this, and I hope it can penetrate your heart, and I hope it can make an impression on me and you, and it can boost us with the correct spirit. Allah said, صدقوا صدقوا وهم شهداء.
Oh Musa, your followers are saying the absolute truth.
That was the condition of this man. He was a sinner, he was a transgressor.
إلا أنه لما حضره الموت.
But when death approached him, and death came to him in a very pitiful condition, he was alone, he was isolated, he was banished, he was expelled, and every one of us wants to die with someone close around us. A father wants to die, his sons are around him, hopefully they've matured, they've understood life, they've got focus. You know, I'm reminded about this dialogue, it's 1 minute I will say it. When Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu, father and son, Amr ibn As was in the throes of death. And really this was the true dialogue of those days. Today I have said in one of my talks recently, the average home has become a hotel. Everybody checks in at his own time and checks out at his own time. Somebody is going to college, someone is going to school, someone is going to office. When they walk in, they're not asking, Salaamu Alaikum, how are you dad, how are you mum? The son walks in and he says, where's my iPad? And then the daughter walks in, where's my iPod? And then the wife says, where's my iPhone? And you ask the father, what about you? He said, I paid. Everybody wants my iPad, my iPod, my iPhone. What about you, brother? He said, I paid. That is why in English they say, he is a wealthy man whose children run into his arms even when his hands are empty. He's a rich man. He's a multi-billionaire by every definition, whose children run into his arms, even if he has nothing monetary in his hand. Otherwise, I'm afraid the average child perceives his father to be nothing more than an ATM machine. So here is it. Amr ibn As slips into a coma. His son Abdullah is there. Both father and son are great sahaba. The father goes into a coma. Then he slips out. The son tells his dad, Dad, I know you're in pain, you're in agony. But I'm just wondering, sifli al-maut. Once you've moved on, I will never ever get the definition of death. While you're dying, if I'm not agonizing you, and I'm not intensifying your trauma, can you briefly describe what death is all about? That was once upon a time the dialogue of a Muslim father and son. That was the grounds of communication. That is what they sat around and discussed. He said, كَأَنَّ جِبَالَ الدُّنْيَا فَوْقَ صَدْرِي My son, you know what? My darling, with a tear in my eye and a crack in my voice, I feel like the mountains of the entire world are resting on my chest alone. And then he fell unconscious again. And there's this prolonged silence. And then the son nudges the father. And the father gets up. He said, "Dad, I'm so sorry. I hate doing this to you. But can you complete that sentence for me? وَكَأَنِّي أَتَنَفَّسُ مِنْ ثِقْبِ الْإِبْرَةِ." The second sentence is, "Oh my son, I feel the mountains of the whole world on my chest, and I'm trying to breathe through the eye of a needle, through the hole of a needle. I'm gasping, I'm battling, I'm really grappling with myself." He said this, and then he made the famous dua, "Allahumma la qawiyun fa'antasir, wa la bariyun fa'a'tadir, wa la mustankirun bal mustaghfirun." That, "Oh Allah, I'm not strong that I'm going to challenge the angel of death, and I'm not innocent that I'm going to argue with him. I admit all my wrongs and I ask for forgiveness," and he passed on. So, oh Musa, listen here, and we end with this here. This man, at the critical moment, when he looked around him, نَظَرَ يُمْنَةً وَيُسْرَةً فَلَمْ يَرَ حَمِيمًا وَلَا قَرِيبًا. He, like any human, was looking for a shoulder, or for somebody to wipe his tearing eye, or somebody to comfort him. He looked in the distance to the right. He couldn't even see a human or an animal or a bird flying. He looked to the left. He couldn't see anything. So then he lifted his gaze to me and he started speaking to me. And he said to me, "Look at this person. This man's destiny changed in the 11th hour. I'm saying this to put hope into everyone. I'm the biggest criminal, and I'm not referring to you, but every one of us needs to patch our relation with our Creator." So he looked at me to the heavens and he said, "Ilahi, لو علمت أن عذابك يزيد في ملكك لما سألتك المغفرة." Oh my Allah, I am talking to you. And I often say to people, dua is something where you talk to Allah. You talk. You just don't ask. Remember one thing. I met one person one day, he was fishing. So I asked him, "How's the fishing going?" He said, "I am enjoying the day outside and having a relaxing day. The fish is a bonus." When you're making dua to Allah, that is the ibadah. The acceptance is a bonus. When you're making dua to Allah, how dare we make dua conditional to acceptance? Allah, if you accept, I will make dua. What am I telling my Allah? No, I will pray. That's my job. That's my duty. You are not bound. You are not compelled. You are not under any obligation. It's my duty to beg, and you are at liberty to grant. You are at liberty to grant. So we talk to Allah. So he spoke to Allah. And that's the beauty. Talk to Allah. Just don't ask. Just don't be formal. Ask Allah. Obviously, when you're asking, Al-Abdu Abdun wa in taraqqa wa Rabbu Rabbun wa in tanazzal. The Arabic poet said, "The Lord remains elevated even when he descends, and the servant remains humble even when he's elevated." So I mustn't trespass. I mustn't trespass. So let's wrap up here. So he looked up and he said, "Ilahi, oh my Allah, if by you punishing me, it was going to add to your glory and your grandeur, and it was going to raise your bar, then I'm not going to ask you for forgiveness, Allah, because you need to climb the levels of glory. But you are at the pinnacle of supremacy. You are at the height of greatness. Forgive me, and you don't have to answer to the whole cabinet. You don't have to write out a report. You don't have to submit a document. There isn't any recourse against you. This thing doesn't filter down into the other arenas. If you forgive me as much as I'm not deserving, Allah, this is your choice. And by you forgiving me, if it's going to drop and diminish you, I won't ask. But I know, my Allah, by you forgiving me, my entire matter will be rescued. And for you, my Allah, you remain the highest. Oh Musa, wa izzati wa jalali." Musa, the way this man asked me, those of us that are fathers and parents, we know. A child can upset you. They can throw a tantrum, build this aggression in you. And then after that, your toddler comes with an innocent smile. And that smile just vanishes and drowns all your grief. And the other child would say, "But look at how unfair this father is. You know, he just came and gave a hug and my dad forgave him." It's a parent, and you know the innocence of that child. Allah, who is the most kind and the most merciful. He said, "Oh Musa, I was so touched by his communication. I was so impressed by his request that not only had I forgiven him, if he had to put on his list of requests the whole world, surely he was going to walk away with what he wanted. So this is what I say to you, my brother. My time has left. I leave you with an English saying, and I hope it will penetrate your heart and my heart. In English they say, regardless of how tainted your past is, your future is still spotless. Regardless of how contaminated, how polluted, how tainted your past is, your future is still spotless. It's clean, my brother. The past is the past. Yes, we're not saying ignore it. But the present is a gift. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will value the blessed month of Ramadan, and we spend it in a manner that is pleasing to him, and we are among those people whose forgiveness and pardon is announced before the crescent of Eid is spotted. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.